Are we going to actually make fusion? We're going to make fusion. Are we going to make fusion? We're not going to make fusion, but we're close to making fusion. Two fusion plants in Europe did weird new things in February, and like a hot gas, I am so excited. First, the Joint European Torus, or JET, was able to sustain fusion for 5 seconds. 5 seconds, that might seem short, but in fusion time, it is ages. Then, on the same day, crazily, the variable configuration Tokamak in Switzerland used Google's DeepMind AI to help the plasma stick in their fusion reactor and did things that human brains would never have even thought to try. Together, these favorable fusion findings are making the future look frickin' fulgent. But what does it all mean? Don't worry, I got you, fam. Hey there, nerd fam. Oh my God, we're back. Hey, I missed you. Being a dad is great. Thank you for the support during my paternity leave. I took some of the time to build this new studio. I hope you love it. But now we have a new video because there was a fusion update. The old joke about fusion is that it's always 30 years away, and it might still be 30 years away. But it's worth the wait because now we are getting close. But before we get too far, let's explain what fusion is. And if you know what this is already, just, you know, next chapter. Nuclear energy comes in two flavors, fission and fusion. Fission is what nuclear plants do today all over the world. You take big, bulky, heavy atoms like uranium, you smash them, and so you can create smaller, lighter atoms, but those lighter atoms are radioactive, and in the process you release heat, but it gets really messy. And the whole point is to generate heat to turn a turbine. Fission is this. Fusion takes hydrogen, the lightest element we know of, and smooshes it together with another bit of hydrogen until it makes helium and releases heat that way. It's sort of the exact opposite of fission. So fusion is sort of like doing this. Fusion is the pinnacle of energy generation as far as we know. Until we can pull energy from like another dimension or something, fusion is the goal. You would think that this would be easy. If we can break atoms apart, why can't we just smush them together? But it requires a lot of heat, energy, and pressure. And nuclear energy and nuclear studies, they're almost 100 years old, but we ain't got it yet. These two advances bring us a bit closer to fusion success. One of the best ways we have right now to make fusion a reality is a tokamak reactor. It's like, how do I explain? Hang on. It's a donut. It's like a donut of magnetic fields. There's one magnetic field running around the outside of the tokamak this way, and then another one going through the middle this way. And inside the donut is a superheated plasma of heavy hydrogen fuel. As the plasma heats, it wants to flex and wiggle, which in a fusion plant, by the way, would cause a catastrophic failure.
Delicious failure. But that would happen.
Oh no, I got powdered sugar all over me. With my misophonia, it's like the worst thing.
Okay. So, a third magnetic field is involved to help shape that hot plasma ring. And remember that for a second because it's important to one of these two discoveries. Once it gets hot enough, the hydrogen inside of that tokamak starts to fuse. It essentially just runs into each other and smooshes together, making helium and releasing heat. The fusion from the plasma then generates that power and keeps the plant going. Mechanical power plants all use turbines to generate electricity. We have to find ways to turn a magnet and a coiled wire to make power, electricity. Wind and water use wind and water to turn turbines, but everybody else uses steam. Coal, oil, natural gas, they all burn stuff to make steam. Geothermal takes heat from the earth to make steam, and nuclear fission and fusion make it from nuclear interactions. But now that you know how fusion does its thing, hopefully you can really appreciate these two new breakthroughs. First, the Joint European Torus, or JET, was able to sustain fusion for 5 seconds with plasma 10 times hotter than the center of the sun. It's literally the hottest place in our solar system when it's on. It set a new world record. They generated 59 megajoules, or 11 megawatts of power averaged over 5 seconds. That's enough to run 7,000 donut fryers. Yum. We need to maintain fusion for long periods of time in order to be able to actually make it a practical energy source, right? And to be able to maintain it for a long period of time not only involves keeping it on, but it also involves keeping that plasma bubble within the donut for as long as possible, as safely as possible. Remember the third magnetic field thing, though, that I told you to remember? The one around the outside. It's called the control field, and it keeps the superheated plasma spinning and fusing within the donut reactor so it doesn't contact the walls and end up with a catastrophic failure. The second fusion story comes in there. The plasma used in a fusion plant is actually not hydrogen. It's heavy hydrogen. It's essentially hydrogen with an extra neutron. However, once it's heated up, the electron flies away. So now it's positively charged, meaning you can use a magnet to move it around. That's why there's all these magnetic coils within a fusion plant. The VCT Tokamak in Switzerland has 19 magnetic coils holding that plasma. And originally each one had its own algorithm reacting to the wiggly plasma inside the reactor, which doesn't really make sense, right? 19 different computers all trying to react locally to what was going on in the plasma isn't as efficient as one big computer. But they didn't have one big computer. But you know who does? Exactly! So what they did is they wired all of those different algorithmic magnets into Alphabet's DeepMind AI, which is fancy words for they taught the algorithms to react and control to the plasma. Now, I'm no expert, but in simple terms, essentially, they used to have one algorithm that would change the field in response to what the plasma was doing locally, just at that one spot around the donut. Now, they're sort of zooming out. They're tying all of those together and trying to make the machine understand the goal rather than the task. At least that's how I read it. Let me break it down a little further. AIs like this are trained by people. Think of it like when you tell your phone who someone is in the photo that you're looking at. It uses that data to guess that person's face in other photos. The more sample photos you give it, the better it will do at guessing the future people. This is my friend Ben, that's also my friend Ben, and this is him without a beard, and this is him with a beard, and this is him in sunglasses, and this is him in a red shirt, and that's him in a blue shirt. The same thing happened here. They showed the machine a big data set, essentially how they wanted the plasma to be shaped, the successes they had had, and then the magnetic fields were kind of just given over to the machine. The plasma would wiggle around trying to escape the magnetic field, and the AI computer would learn to hold it better and better, and eventually it could even maintain two separate plasma rings within the reactor, which they never had done before. Imagine if the computer got so good that it could recognize Ben's face in the dark, in the background, with or without a beard, no matter what he was wearing, even if the pic was super blurry. And that is the example that we're thinking of with the future of fusion. Imagine after years of trying and training, what will this be able to do? Because if this is the first step, it's only gonna get better from here. Hopefully, but you know, hopefully. The extra wild thing here is that neither JET nor the VCT that did these experiments are power plants. They're just experimental facilities. That's how bad humans want fusion. They're trying to build things that just test if it works. A bigger, more advanced, and more powerful tokamak called Eater is under construction in France. They're claiming that if it works, they'll put in 50 megawatts and get out 500 megawatts. That's enough to power every donut shop in the world. Maybe. We'll see if they successfully try it out for the first time in 2025. And unlike in the past, scientists today have a little more heat under their butts to get this done. Literally planetary heat. The IPCC just released a climate impact report that basically says shit's bad. Like, not inevitable destruction of everything tomorrow bad, but like, not that many more tomorrows if we do nothing. And it's getting worse faster than we thought. We need less air pollution, like now. Less CO2 and methane in the air, because those greenhouse gases are going to kill us. The best way to do that is to transition from burning dead biomatter for fuel into absorbing it from heat generated by solar, fission, or fusion. Hydro and wind, also great. Remember, we're just turning turbines. When it comes to generating energy, nuclear has the highest energy unit per low pollution unit calculation. It generates the most energy with the least pollution. Coal babies love to talk about how much punch and power is in fossil fuels, and sure, there is a lot of power contained within hydrocarbon chains, but a fusion ratio is about 4 million times more energetic than the chemical reaction of oil, gas, or coal. Let me put it in a different perspective. The power of a fusion plant might only take a few hundred kilograms of fuel a year to run. A coal plant, on the other hand, needs 2.7 billion kilograms, like a few hundred kilograms per minute. Right now, it is cheaper to dig up biomatter and burn it, I'll give you that, but it's temporary. Because fusion uses a fuel that's more abundant, cheaper, and easier to get. This. Australia, wait, no, not Australia, just the seawater. Regular old seawater. Well, actually, it's deuterium. With fusion, that gallon of seawater could power a car for nearly a year. And that's because 1/5,000th of every gallon of seawater is deuterium. It's everywhere. Even if we went through all the water in the world, we would still only have used 1/5,000th of all the seawater out there. Fusion is ridiculously powerful, clean, and efficient. It's also extremely difficult to achieve, which is why these breakthroughs are such a big deal. And if COVID-19 has taught us anything, a motivated populace and political class can accomplish a lot of science in a really short time, so maybe we should start with fusion. In the end, if we can get fusion to work, we're gonna have a cleaner, more abundant energy future, and you won't have to feel bad at all about plugging in your car or turning on your television any time of day or night, because it'll be powered the same way as the sun and all the other stars in the sky, by squishing two little atoms together. To paraphrase Arthur C. Clarke, making super clean energy using a donut-shaped mini sun run by an AI would definitely be technology that is indistinguishable from magic. Honestly, if we can get fusion to work, we're like well on our way to becoming a type 1 civilization. Check out this video here if you haven't seen it already. If you liked this video, you're gonna love that one. Thank you so much to my patrons who stuck around even though I wasn't making videos for the past couple months. I'm really just so appreciative, so thank you so much. Thanks again for sticking around during my break, and I'll see you in the future.